Ông quỳ chỗ. Ông dùng đẹp cảm tốt cái dùm là cả để tệ phí sạm là cả. Hãy tốt tình đích bảo cả chuyên tư sạm vì cả việc đấy. Đâm bày xua tùm nguồn đến đầu dịp vụ sạm nhạy dùm niên. Đã dùm chênh lục. Mình sẽ bị bây giờ cục bế.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Good morning.
Madam Expert,
I've
only very limited time, so let's see if I can cover as many subjects with you as possible. I would like to start with a follow-up question in relation to your PhD. In your PhD, on the very first page, you write that it is in full completion of PhD requirements. You also mentioned David Chandler as your primary advisor. You also talked about him 2 days ago. Was he involved in ultimately acknowledging that all your PhD requirements were met?
To clarify, I started my PhD at another university in New Zealand, completed probably half my study, and then transferred to Monash University. I had two supervisors, though Professor Chandler was my primary supervisor. The other was Marie-Christiane, who was the director of the Monash Asia Institute. So both of them would have had to make sure everything was in order before my thesis was sent to the committee for the recognition that it was in order before it was sent to overseas to international examiners.
I understand now. I'm not sure what the Australian academic tradition is, but is there at any, was there at any point in time a necessity for you to defend your methodology
toward your promoters, sponsors, or
whomever?
Yes, it's a little different than the American system that I went through the first time with the committee of five that you defend your thesis in front of. In the Australian system, you have to defend it in a room with your supervisors and others who are unrelated to your thesis, who are in that room for peer review, and then you do a public presentation. It's an advertised presentation. And people throughout the university in different disciplines come to that presentation. And then, finally, it moves forward to be ready to be sent out for its final review. And in that stage, yes, the methodology is essential to be clear.
At the very end of everything, has your methodology been accepted in all its entirety?
Yes, it has.
I presume the same with the conclusions that you drew at the end of your research.
Yes, because the international reviewers who read it and marked it and claimed that it was worthy of passing for a degree track the methodology as they were tracking the analysis throughout the thesis. That is their role.
I understand, but I just want to have that on record. Is there any discrepancy between what you have said and defended in terms of methodology and conclusions, between on the one hand your dissertation, and on the other hand, the things that you have been saying here in court for the past 2.5 days. Is there any big contradiction or discrepancy or anything different in your views?
No.
Thank you for this. Let me move to another topic now. I was struck by what you said on the very first day about the issue of marriage. You called it a very heated topic. You talk about the intensity of this topic. You said there was an agenda. You stayed fairly general in this because of time. Would you be able to expand a bit more on what you meant with this?
Yes, during the course of the beginning of my study, there were people that were becoming interested in the topic. People who have actually been in this courtroom before, who had conversations with me, more specifically, Stukinsky, had exchanges with me, asking me questions about my research. And during that time, when I was offering trends rather than my conclusions, I didn't have conclusions yet when I was in those conversations. There were some meetings and then there were some email exchanges. And in those email exchanges, what I noted was that there was a tendency to want to convince me of a particular way of looking at the weddings. And in those exchanges, I stood behind my research. I actually have one here, an email. I'll just read just one sentence at my side because it's my, I'll read my email that I sent because I don't have permission from this other person to read their email exchange to me. This was later in the process, 8th of August 2008. Anthropologists save everything, by the way, as documents. I received your press release and will send a response in the next day or two. I, of course, can only speak from the research study I did over the course of 8 years, but think your 100% claims may be less than consistent with my findings. I could not make an argument against the way you have phrased your claims. Oh, I could make an argument against the way you phrase your claims in paragraph 4. If you would like, I can write that. My concerns are so that your argument can be there was a trend that I documented regionally, and I wrote about those trends and said, you know, more about my own study. It's an example of the kind of exchanges that I had that then moved me in some ways to go into seclusion with my work. And it's quite easy to see that when I've given interviews in the media at times, if it's an opinion page, there'll be a backlash opinion page. So I do think it is an emotional topic. I think it needs to be an emotional topic. But emotion without reliability may not actually be portraying what happened as it happened.
A very short follow-up question in this regard. Have you read the newspapers this morning?
I have not.
Then don't. Let me move on to my next subject. That is the issue of a national policy. We've only briefly touch upon the 12 revolutionary principles. The way or the importance of these principles to the revolutionary cadres of the CPK. Yesterday you were asked a question about the Constitution about what Ing Seri had said in 1980. There is in fact evidence of Pol Pot also speaking about marriage policy or marriage as such. Are you familiar with what Pol Pot said sometime in August, September 75 to a Belgian delegation?
If you can refresh my memory, please.
Let me read to you what he said. Mr. President, I will be referring to a figures report, B3/76. It's what he said on the 5th of August, 1978. And English ERN, it is 001704246, Khmer 013-27012, no French translation yet. And this is what he says. On building up a family, the young men and young women build up families on a voluntary basis. After marriage, should problems arise within the family, the masses give advice to the partners in order to sort out their problem. Should the parties concerned find it impossible to cohabit any longer, they have the choice of divorce. Neither of the parties concerned needs to go to court.
It goes on a bit further,
were you aware of this excerpt of his interview with the Belgian delegation?
I was. Now
taking what he says into account, taking also into consideration the revolutionary principles and its importance and its implementation already since the 60s. My question is about logic or common sense of any alleged policy. If it is indeed true that one of DK's objectives was to increase the population, wouldn't it be illogical and contrary to common sense to force people to marry? Because if you force people to marry, procreation will, by definition or naturally, not come easy or will be much more difficult. So my question is, isn't the policy as described by Pol Pot in August 78 and as established in the revolutionary principle a logical policy which doesn't entail any forcible nature of weddings?
Firstly, I'm not sure if that's a policy. I mean, it's interesting. I've thought about the revolutionary codes, but I also have thought about the gender codes of conduct. I know primarily in the courts, the female roles of conduct have been presented, but there's a PhD student who finished his PhD in February 2014 at Victoria University in Melbourne, and he did his PhD thesis on the topic of that included, among other things, the male gender codes of conduct.
And
those gender male codes, and when I look at the female ones as well, a lot of those run right through some of the revolutionary principles, especially about warning against adultery. So what I can say at this moment is what Pol Pot had said then. Would align with a potential policy to have people in exclusive relationships first before one thinks about consummation of that relationship. I'd have to ponder more your question about the logic.
But I understand that. Let me move on to another topic which was discussed extensively last days, and that is a climate of fear or sort of a general climate of coercion. Would you agree with me that the existence, if at all, existence of a climate of fear or in the daily lives the men and women you interviewed depended on the approach of the local authorities, people like the village chiefs, etc.? They who were by far the most responsible for any climate of fear. Would you agree with me on this?
Object is clearly beyond the witness's expertise. She's never claimed to know anything about security centers, arrests, the structure of the leadership of the Democratic Cambodia.
Perhaps a more open question would be more appropriate. Do you feel confident to tell us what you think was the reason or who was responsible in the wider sense, not necessarily legally, for this climate of fear, or does this go beyond the scope of your study? You told us there was this climate of fear. That's how I understood you. Would you feel comfortable as an expert? And you have occasionally said, and we are grateful for that, I don't know, I'm assuming now. So I think what we want to know is, do you know something about that? Do you feel comfortable to say this climate of fear coercion was brought about by, and we are talking people in this, and I think that's what council is interested in, not philosophical concepts, but who, if anybody, was responsible for that? Do you feel comfortable to give an answer to that on the basis of your research?
Yes.
Yeah.
So my answer with regard to the locals and this fear is that the locals cushioned or exacerbated fear. To me, in my research, first of all, let's start with the baseline of fear. Okay, there was the baseline of fear was very high. But given the high baseline of fear, that was exacerbated and went above that baseline, or perhaps went a bit below that baseline, depending on the treatment that people received by those who were in charge of them, usually in local
locales. Thank you. Let me follow up on this and ask you a bit more about the term Angkar. Is there, in the interviews that you had with the respondents, a shift in perception of Angkar and what it was sometime in 1977, is there, or anywhere else for that matter, is there a difference in perception in a certain period? As you said, that all kinds of things depend on time and place, etc. Was the same also applicable in relation to Angkar?
Yes.
And when did that change start to take place?
It was around 1977.
Let me ask you if you are familiar with a CPK Standing Committee Directive on the use of the terms Angkar and Party. Mr. President, I'll be referring to E3/740, English year N 00305412, Khmer 00082731, French 00983932. And it says, among other things, the following. It's Son Sen, actually, who is directing every division, regiment, and office for implementing this directive. As observed in the past, some people in units have confusingly used the terms Angkar and Party. In some places, bad elements and elements of the internally hidden enemy, have misleadingly used the term Angkar to a larger extent to cheat and destroy the party and the revolution. And then a bit further, therefore the party central committee would like to issue a directive to every local base, ministry, office, and unit as follows. The term Angkar or party is used only for the organization. It shall not be used for any individual. Concretely, is this something that somehow corresponds with that change that you also observed?
No.
Can you explain what you meant then with the change that you were able to observe?
So 22% of the people I interviewed claimed that Angkar was a leader, 48% a mythical transforming force, 30% didn't know. So that's why that information didn't get to 30%, perhaps. But this is a cultural artifact, and I claim in my thesis it's a cultural artifact that Khmer Rouge did not and could not, I think, have accounted for. But there are factors, I believe, and I mapped them out starting in my book, and you should have access that on page 159, where I mapped out the cult based processes that were in place during the regime that heightened this cultural artifact that happened because of the culture in which this decay force was taking seed.
I would
love to follow up on this, but I don't have time. So let me move to, unfortunately, my last question. And that is the following. You've talked about the evidence that you saw given here in this court testimony in the courtroom
of the civil parties. And
you said that you do not doubt the veracity of that evidence. Now, having said that, I also recall at one point in time you used the words anecdotal evidence, not in this relation, but in another respect. My question to you is the following. How can we establish, or what ways should we proceed to be able to determine whether the evidence that has been given in this courtroom is anecdotal, rather than reflecting a structural It's a very difficult question, I understand, but I hope you will be able to answer it.
I would hope someone would do a PhD thesis on the topic of how civil party members were selected, how the interviews were conducted, how the material in the interviews were cross-checked. I gave you an example of one transcript where something very important was left out. I don't question the integrity of civil party members and what they bring forward into this court. I have listened to those testimonies. I don't question that. What I question, perhaps, is the judgment and the values and the drivenness, perhaps, of some of the organizations that may have been involved in them getting to the point of being in this courtroom.
Thank you very much.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour, Madame Levine. Quelques minutes qui me restent pour d'obtenir quelques clarifications sur certains points. Dans le cadre de son interrogatoire, Monsieur le coprocureur a utilisé, en parlant du mariage sous le Kampuchea démocratique, la notion de, en anglais, c'était free will, je ne sais pas comment je vais le traduire en français, volonté, libre arbitre. Et ça m'a renvoyé à ce que vous aviez indiqué au départ sur votre choix de méthodologie qui était de ne pas porter de jugement sur ce qui était le mariage, comment se former les mariages au départ, que ce soit sous le Kampuchea démocratique ou avant, avec une vision qui était eurocentrée. Je schématise un petit peu. Et hier, en parlant du cas de Moni, vous avez dit Oui, elle disait qu'elle ne voulait pas se marier, mais de toute façon, elle se serait mariée sur la volonté de ses parents. C'est une longue question, je suis désolée. Et ça me renvoie également à une observation qu'a faite l'expert Nakagawa le 13 septembre 2016. C'était un petit peu aux alentours de 10h42. Et 29 secondes. Et voilà ce qu'elle dit. Là, elle parle spécialement des femmes sur dans le cadre d'un mariage Khmer traditionnel. Et voilà ce qu'il dit. In regard to the woman's decision-making power, there was almost zero. So a daughter was given the instruction or order to marry with somebody by her parents. And mostly, the daughters were expecting the parents to make a decision for her. On the other hand, the boys had more freedom, and boy could initiate their own marriages by proposing to his parents or guardians or relatives who could approach to the parents of the girl that he wants to marry. At any case, mostly the weddings were arranged by the parents and decided by the parents. So even though the boy wanted to marry with the girl that he loves, his parents disapproved, it could have been extremely difficult for him to proceed to seek for the approval from the marriage.
End of quote.
La raison pour laquelle je vous pose cette question en relation avec ce que vous-même vous avez dit par rapport à votre approche et à la façon dont les gens ont évoqué le mariage, y compris sous le Kampuchea démocratique, c'est que je voudrais savoir si cette manière dont les mariages étaient organisés et la manière dont la volonté des deux éventuels conjoints n'était pas centrale dans l'organisation du mariage, est-ce que ça a une incidence sur votre sur le fait que vous n'avez pas posé la question est-ce que vous avez voulu vous marier ou est-ce que c'était un mariage ou plutôt sur votre choix de prendre cette phrase neutre, est-ce que c'était un mariage réel? Est-ce que cette manière dont traditionnellement le free will dont parlait monsieur le procureur n'était pas au centre des individus, enfin de la question du mariage des individus, plutôt le free will, où cette volonté des individus n'était pas au centre du mariage, est-ce que c'est ce qui vous a conduit aussi à poser vos questions d'une certaine manière? Je sais que ma question était très longue, mais je voulais remettre les choses dans leur contexte et savoir si ma compréhension des choses était la bonne.
Firstly, I don't think it's inconsistent to ask about authenticity, but not forced. Though I don't stand in full agreement of Ms. Nakagawa's reference, and I am aware that the studies that she's done in terms of violence have been identified before the studies begin.
Obligation to find for their own.
is very important in the male code of honor.
Having said that, there is a factor here that when weddings are arranged,
I hold out the 1970 beginning period of the
law and order and the
foundational cultural factor that people do what they're obliged to do. Parents arrange the marriage, they do that through lots of discussion, and it's not a nuclear
I don't believe the question was answered. It's probably, I don't think it's the expert's fault. It was a 10-minute introduction, but the question that I understood from the speech of defense counsel was, why was it that you did not ask the respondents to the survey, or the students ask, why, whether they consented to the marriage? That's what I understood counsel's question to me. Suggestions about why the expert may not have asked that question.
I think at the time it would be productive to have the witness answer the question.
Encore une fois, Monsieur le coprocureur intervient dans mon interrogatoire. C'est vrai que ma question était longue et peut-être qu'il y a des choses qui sont perdues dans la traduction, mais ma question n'était pas telle qu'elle a été comprise par Monsieur le coprocureur. Et comme je n'ai pas beaucoup de temps, j'avance. Vous avez indiqué également hier que lorsque Monsieur le coprocureur vous soumettait certains exemples de récits, que c'était difficile pour vous d'isoler des récits par rapport à l'ensemble de l'étude pour répondre aux questions. Un certain nombre de statistiques ont été données ou d'exemples ont été donnés de l'autre côté de la barre et j'ai repris votre annexe avec le détail des différents récits, enfin le résumé de ces différents récits. Il ressort de l'analyse de cette annexe, donc il se retrouve à partir de la page 216 de votre thèse E3-1794. Que sur les 192 personnes que vous avez entendues, 29 d'entre elles ont indiqué que les parents étaient à l'origine du choix de leur conjoint et 25 ont mentionné que c'était soit l'un, soit l'autre des conjoints ou soit les deux ensemble s'étaient mis d'accord avant d'aller demander l'autorisation à l'encart. En tout, ça fait 28% de mariages pour lesquels il y a soit un choix des parents, soit un choix d'un des deux conjoints ou des deux conjoints. Ma question est la suivante. Quand vous avez évoqué dans vos conclusions la notion de mariage conscrit, est-ce que vous évoquez également ces 28% ou est-ce que c'est une tendance générale que vous envisagez?
In part, I'm speaking about the general tendency, but in part, my selection of that term, let me step back. Those weddings that were still arranged, the parents brought names to the leader to ask permission for their daughter or their son to marry. They still had to get permission. So it wasn't, though one could see that as arranged, in an arrangement, the dynamics of the community are different. Somebody doesn't go. Let's take this outside of the DK period. Somebody doesn't go to the village chief and say, I want to get permission from you so that my son or daughter can marry. Now, it doesn't say that the village chief doesn't give his two cents worth. But that's a little bit of a difference there. But to answer your question, yes, I was looking at general patterns, at general themes, that's the way I can form some semblance of conclusion. And I also want to say that those weddings in which parents participate in arranging, I can say that, it happened at certain times. There was a period that was very dire where that didn't happen for a while, where the parents had less voice, and that's the time I have selected as a time of real change of going from the what, I guess I said earlier, is the flying by the seat of the pants, trying to figure out, we're doing something here, what are we doing, we better speak up and get it right. And that was really around the 78, that's why my 79 cohort is so interesting for me to reflect on. I could see some changes. And also patterns of communication from 1978.
Du coup, j'aurais une question de suivi sur les mariages, les 28% dont je viens de parler, qui étaient les mariages où il y a eu des propositions de la part des parents ou une demande de la part d'un des deux conjoints ou des deux. Est-ce que vous les situez précisément dans le temps? Est-ce que ça a changé? A priori, plusieurs exemples, notamment, je vais prendre le numéro 2, où c'est une personne qui a demandé le numéro 2, où c'est une personne qui a demandé l'autorisation. Là, je vois en 78, il y a le numéro 1 du tableau. C'est une personne qui a demandé, là, c'est en décembre 78. Une autre fois, je vois novembre 78 sur le numéro 7. Ensuite, je vois août 78 pour le numéro 10. Je vois 77 pour le numéro 12. Est-ce qu'il y avait un schéma sur ce type de mariage demandé par la famille ou par un des conjoints par type d'année? Ou est-ce que c'est étendu selon les régions et selon le temps? J'ai bien compris qu'il y avait des distinctions selon le temps et les régions. Est-ce que vous pouvez, vous avez vu un schéma particulier sur ces types de
mariages?
I saw a shift in the selection process depending on who was the leader in a region at a particular time.
And
I also saw that in 1976,
there was
some
weddings
that had many
different
elements
to
them. And I know it's outside the period of the court, but in late 79, When some Khmer were giving approval for weddings, they were becoming more arranged, and there were some
traditions coming back.
J'en termine de mon interrogatoire. Merci, Monsieur le Président, pour ces minutes supplémentaires.
ខ្ញុំអស់ដែរហើយចឹងខ្ញុំសូមបញ្ចប់ការសួរសំណួរខ្ញុំនៅពេលនេះតែម្ដងហើយលោកប្រធានសូមអរគុណដែលបានផ្ដល់ពេលវេលាបន្ថែមមកខ្ញុំបាទអរគុណសម្រាប់ការស្ដាប់ប្រកិកម្មសាក់សីអ្នកជំនាញភីកលវាញ់បានដល់ទីបញ្ចប់ហើយអង្គជំរះសូមអរគុណកញ្ញាអ្នកជំនាញបណ្ឌិតភីកលវាញ់ដែលបានចំណាយពេលវេលាដ៏មានតម្លៃធ្វើដំណើរមកពីនាយសមុទ្រហើយនឹងត្រូវបានចំណាយពេលវេលាអរិយពេល 1 សប្តាហ៍រងចាំនៅទីក្រុងភ្នំពេញដែលមូលហេតុទឹកជំនន់លេចទីធ្លាបរិវេណនៅអបតកនេះហើយក្នុងការបំរើតក្រីកម្មនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំរះក្នុងរយៈឋានៈជាអ្នកជំនាញក្នុងរយៈពេល 3 ថ្ងៃកន្លងមកនេះប្រកបដោយភាពអត់ធ្មត់គុណធម៌និងសិលធម៌វិជ្ជាជីវៈខ្ពស់ហើយតក្រីកម្មរបស់កញ្ញាបណ្ឌិតនឹងអាចរួមវិភាគទានសំខាន់ក្នុងការស្វែងរកការពិតនៅរឿងក្តីនេះ ហើយវត្តមានរបស់កញ្ញាបណ្ឌិតនៅអបតកនេះលែងមានភាពចាំបាច់ទៀតហើយកញ្ញាបណ្ឌិតអាចបើត្រឡប់ទៅកាន់លំនៅឋានឬកកូដៅណាដែលកញ្ញាមានបំណងចង់ទៅហើយហើយសូមកញ្ញាមានទុកភាពល្អជួបតែសំណាងល្អបានក្តីសុខក្តីចម្រើននិងទទួលបានជោគជ័យថ្មីៗថែមទៀតនិងធ្វើដំណើរប្រកបដោយសុវត្ថិភាពហើយមន្ត្រីរដ្ឋបាលតុលាការត្រូវរួមជាមួយនឹងអង្គមន្ត្រីនៃអង្គភាពគំពីសាក់សីនិងអ្នកជំនាញក្នុងការជូនអ្នកជំនាញប្រតិបត្តិការ កន្លែងនេះគាត់ស្នាក់នៅវិញចុះសូមកញ្ញាបណ្ឌិតអញ្ជើញចាក់ចេញពីបន្ទប់សម្ណាការបាទហើយនេះពេលនេះបាទតទៅនេះអង្គមេមានបញ្ហាបន្តិចបន្តួចហើយសូមទីមួយគឺផ្សព្វផ្សាយនៅទីតម្រាច់មួយពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងសំណើរបស់មេធាវីនរមុខតំណាងដើមរឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹង ដើមដងរដ្ឋវិនីដែលមានថាជំនាមពី CCP 298ដែលនឹងធ៣កាល៤៨ដែលនឹងធ្វើមកផ្ដល់ទៅខីកម្មនៅរុស្ស៊ីនេះអង្គជំរះបានទទួលសំណើរបស់សហមេធាវីនរមុខតំណាងដើមដងរដ្ឋវិនីឯកសារ E 419 ដែលតាក់ទងទៅនឹងដើមដងរដ្ឋវិនី2 TCP 298ដែលត្រូវបានកំណត់ឲ្យមកផ្ដល់ទៅខីកម្មបន្ទាប់ពីអ្នកជំនាញ2 TCE 861អង្គជំរះក៏ថ្កោលថាឯកសារដែលបានស្នើឡើងនេះមានពាក្យសុំតាំងខ្លួនជាដើមដងរដ្ឋវិនីរបស់ដើមដងរដ្ឋវិនី2 TCCP 298និងទម្រង់បែបបទព័ត៌មានបន្ថែមចំនួន2 1ក្នុងថ្ងៃទី29ខែមិថុនាឆ្នាំ2010និង1ទៀតចុះថ្ងៃទី21ខែមិថុនាឆ្នាំ2013អង្គជំរះបញ្ជាក់ថាពាក្យសុំតាំងខ្លួនជាដើមដងរដ្ឋបវេណីនិងទម្រង់បែបបទព័ត៌មានបន្ថែមចុះថ្ងៃទី21ខែមិថុនាឆ្នាំ2010ត្រូវបានទទួលយកធ្វើជាឯកសារភស្តុតាងក្នុងសំណុំរឿង002/02រួចហើយដោយកំណត់លេខឯកសារដាច់ពីគ្នាគឺ
ສາຍສຳເພິລ 9 ສາຍສຳເພິລ 73 ສໍາລັບປຽກສົມນັງ ໂຕໃບຈະຢ່າງນາກໍໄດ້ອ້ອຍຍໍາແຮັບກໍຕົງກໍເຄີຍຖ້າເອກະສານຊີພາສາຄໄມໃນເອກະສານ ឯកសារជាភាសាអង់គ្លេសទាំងលើពាក្យសុំតាំងខ្លួនជាដើមរងរដ្ឋវិនីនិងទម្រង់បែបបទមានអព័រមានបន្ថែមចុះថ្ងៃទី 21/9 ខែមិថុនាឆ្នាំ 2013 ដែលមានលេខ EON 09 09 57 ដល់ 01 09 94 88 អង្គយមរះក៏ទំព័រថាឯកសារទាំងពីរទំព័រនៃឯកសារ E 319/58.3.3នេះមិនទាន់ត្រូវបានទទួលយកធ្វើជាឯកសារភស្តុតាងពីមុនមកនោះទេ ពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងចំណុចនេះអង្គយមរះរំលឹកពីការអនុវត្តរបស់អង្គយមរះក្នុងការទទួលយកចម្លើយពីមុនពីមុនរបស់ដើមដឹងរដ្ឋប្រវេណីនិង សម្រាប់ឯកសារនេះបាទជាបន្តទៅនេះអង្គញាណផ្ដល់ព្រឹត្តិការណ៍ជូនទៅចក្រមសម្ភារៈឡាវែងដើម្បីលើកឡើងនៅបញ្ហាមួយចំនួនលើសំណើសុំរបស់ភាគីពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងសមនាការស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មសាក្សីដែលមានអត្តនាម
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Effectivement,
quelques clarifications concernant l'audition demain du témoin de TCW 960.
La Chambre a été informée
que le juge d'instruction internationale a donné son accord pour communiquer aux parties dossier 2 l'enregistrement audio de l'entretien du témoin de
TCW 960 avec les enseignants du bureau de l'enregistrement.
Il est possible qu'il y ait un petit peu de délai pour que ce document soit effectivement accessible. Je pense que ça va être assez
simple. La
Chambre est saisie d'une requête de la défense de M. Sampan afin de voir déclarer recevable les enregistrements audio des personnes qui ont été entendues dans les dossiers 3 et 4 et dont les procès verbaux et l'addition ont été déclarés recevables au dossier 2. Je voudrais non pas statuer sur l'ensemble de cette requête maintenant, mais je voudrais tout d'abord m'assurer qu'il n'y a pas d'objection de la part des parties à la recevabilité de l'enregistrement audio du témoin de TCW 960. Je ne vois pas d'objection
de la part des parties.
Je pense qu'on peut le noter au transcript.
Monsieur le Président,
We have no objection at this time, but I would like to, I think there are a number of issues I'd like to discuss internally with our team about this. On this one, I will say no objection, but this may not be the policy of our office. I think it's going to, there are a number of issues about the size of the case file and confidentiality of faces, et cetera. So for this particular witness, I have no objection.
Yeah.
Ma demande était bien limitée à l'enregistrement audio de
CCW.
Et je comprends qu'il n'y a pas d'objection d'aucune
partie concernant ce témoignage.
La chambre a statué sur cette requête et je me tourne maintenant vers la défense du
gouvernement pour savoir ce que je crois qu'elle a le souhait
de présenter des observations concernant ce problème des enregistrements audio, est-ce que vous entendez toujours planter d'observation ou non?
L'objet des observations était précisément de savoir où en était cette question des audios, donc vous avez anticipé.
Bien, dans ce cas, la Chambre déclare recevable l'enregistrement audio dont j'ai donné les références tout à l'heure, le
319/52.7R. ให้ประกอบឲ្យอนุเรศอันที่คงแข็งนอมคลวนโลกคือสมพรตลอดตะกันบรรทุกรงจำข้างกรมสาสามนาการนี้ให้นึงเอานอมก็ตลอดจะร่วมนองสามนาการในขนมบรรทุกสามนาการนี้ไว้ในประเทศนี้บันมุนมองมือกันละและสมระจ้ะ